All right. I'm going to update, give an update video of my Ventures collection. Every time I think I'm done with it, I end up finding a few other things. And so this is an update since the last video I did. And here we have Walk Don't Run Volume 2 Ventures album. This is the second pressing, and I've shown this before. There's nothing, or one of these before, not this particular one. I think I showed it even with this is the second pressing because it's got the air. Don's underarm is he had an underarm stain, and it's been airbrushed out. That stain is seen pretty clearly on this copy here, if I can get that in there. But anyway, so. So they had that airbrushed out. So why am I showing yet another one of these? Well, this is a sealed copy, so I'm going to do another one of these where I open the sealed copy. It looks like it's in great shape. And, if I'm going to open a sealed copy, I might as well do it, get a video of it here. And so I thought I'd do that on this one. Maybe some other info I don't know if I mentioned last time. That's Don's wife there, Nancy Bacon. She's in the tabloid news for having an affair with Paul Newman, and that was in the around the time of Sundance Kid. That's reported anyway, as if that's true. And she's written a book. She's still around. She wrote a book about. All the affairs she's had with famous celebrities. She's only married once, and that was to Don Wilson. And but anyway, this album came out in October of '64, and it did very well. I think a lot of it on the strength of their own redoing of their own hit, Walk Don't Run. They did it called Rock Don't Run '64. Noki rearranged it. And they ended up having a hit with that song again. You know, originally they had the hit in 1960 with Walk Don't Run, but they have it rearranged it and put it back out as a single, and all of a sudden it's another hit for them, and that's pretty good. I don't know how often that's ever been done. So the album did very well, hit number 17, made the top 20 albums, into the top 20. For an instrumental group in 1964, after the Beatles, it pretty much wiped out all the California surf music and so many other types of music. Here's the Ventures still able to sell instrumental rock albums with their Venture, with their Mosrite guitars. I think this is the first album where they actually advertise it as the guitar they use exclusively. They used it on two albums previous to this, Fabulous Ventures and In Space. I don't know if they advertised it on Fabulous. Maybe they did. Bob's playing a really nice blue one. This is the Side Jack model. Very coveted, rare. The first 200 Mosrites were like that. Mosrite guitars. This would be one of those early ones. Here's a red one, Side Jack as well. I don't think it's bound. Anyway, this is a wonderful album. I love Blue Star. It's probably my favorite. One of my favorite Ventures tunes of them all. And it's the theme from Medic. And then one of my favorite recordings of them. They didn't write it. Stranger on the Shore, of course, is great. Let's see, Diamond Head's on here, and that was written by Danny Hamilton. I'm sure I've mentioned this before, of Hamilton, Joe Frank, and Reynolds. And one other detail about Hamilton, Joe Frank, and Reynolds is that Joe Barilli played with that band. Now, Joe Barilli joined the Ventures a little later after Mel Taylor, the drummer here, left in the early 70s for a period of time. Anyway, Diamond Head was a big hit in Japan as a single, and it sold like 1.8 million of them, maybe I think something over 1.8 million. So they did very well with that. The album stayed in the charts for 24 weeks. So Leon Russell, I don't know if I mentioned that the first time I put this on, is playing on House of the Rising Sun in a very cool Ventures original called The Creeper. I've talked to Don Wilson about this album when I met him in a studio once, and because I've always thought it was a great album, but his reaction is that, as I recall, he thought this one had too many three-chord songs, or 1-4-5 is what they know, kind of the blues progression, 1-4-5. It's also the early rock. Most of Chuck Berry's songs, you know, are 1-4-5 or a three-chord song. And there are a few on here, but not everything. Night Train's a 1-4-5, maybe Peach Fuzz is too. Nightwalk is definitely one of those. Anyway, but it's a great album. I'm gonna, as I say, I think before I'm done, I'll unseal that one. I'll open it up and we'll see, you know, what's inside and what we can learn from there. Anyway, oh, this is really cool. This I was so happy to find this. This is very hard to find. You know, if you're looking for it, it's hard to find. Imagine what happens is somebody finds one of these in a $2 used bin. You know, this is not a brand new copy. And, you know, they pay $2 for it, and then they find out on eBay that Ventures fans will pay, you know, quite a bit for it. Let's just put it that way. And so it is a retitling of their album called Guitar Freakout, which came out in February of 67. And this is a 1969 re-release of Guitar Freakout. It's not called Guitar Freakout. It's called Revolving Sounds. Well, this is retitled. And anyway, so let's see. This has got to be Liberty. Yeah, this is on Liberty, whereas the original album was their last album on the Dalton label. Again, it was called Guitar Freakout. And I guess, you know, they figured, well, in 1969, maybe they could put a new package, new cover on the album, and it would gain a new audience or something. I don't know how successful that was. In fact, probably wasn't, because as I say, this album's kind of rare. And so it didn't stay in print very long. And it's got this group of Ventures is not the one that played on Guitar Freakout, well, at least some of them. These two in particular, these three are from the original album. That's Don and Bob and Mel. The drummer is Mel, and bass is Bob, and rhythm guitar is Don. But Jerry McGee and Johnny Durrell. Johnny Durrell played with the Five Americans. Western Union was their big hit. And the Five Americans' big hit. And Jerry McGee's played with so many people. Let's see, I think he's in A Star Is Born and playing in Kris Kristofferson's band. Anyway, yeah, this is the Liberty label here. If I can get it better on the screen there. The Liberty label. And, yeah, it's a U.S. version. I understand in England they also have a title of Guitar Freakout called Revolving Sounds. I don't know if I've seen that one or not. But anyway, this is I was so happy to find this. It's quite rare. And so anyway, this is Flights of Fantasy, which I showed on my last video, but a different copy. I mean, I showed it with this cover, pretty much the same thing as the Japanese version of it. But I had the Obi strip on the other one. This one doesn't. So why did I pick up another copy, especially if it doesn't, it's not, you know, not as complete as the other one, not having the Obi strip? Well, this one has an interesting label that I hadn't seen this before. It's hand, or not hand, well, it's typed, is what it is. And you know, so the ink's not consistent. They obviously changed the ribbon before they got to this last song on the typewriter, typing the label. And it's a Japanese pressing. I figured, well, since it's a typed label, maybe this is a test pressing. But it's on red vinyl. It's in a cover. you know, they wouldn't put a test pressing in a nice cover. I don't know, unless it's an old, it was a test pressing that they had around, and then they put it in the cover, I don't know. It's probably a promo is what it is. It's probably a DJ promo. And, you know, some people call them a white label promo. So, it's a great album. And I've talked about it before. The U.S. version came out in April of 68. Didn't do that great on the charts. It was Nokie Edwards' last album. That's all in the previous video. I've talked about it a couple of times in other videos. This is just the New Testament album. I've shown this one in another video as well. And it's hard to read. And Don Wilson thinks this says New Gestamert. And I get that out of Del Halterman's book here. By the way, a quick plug for that book. It's a great book. Who puts it? We have it on Lulu Press, www.lulu.com. Lulu, L-U-L-U. This is such a great book. And this is the second edition of it. So, and so a lot of the information I'm talking about I get out of that book. And that story about John and Don thinking this says New Gestamert. He thinks that's a G. So what really is the title here? Well, the Australians weren't going to put up with this unreadable cover. So I found this recently. It's The Venture. That, you know, they wanted to make sure that The Venture's name. Look how tiny they put The Venture's name on this. I don't know what the marketing department was thinking about. Don, you know, says that we should have taken over titling our albums and maybe taken some more, because The Ventures never did that. The marketing department would always do the album covers. The Ventures would be busy recording. But you can hardly read The Ventures' name on this. And New Testament. Who in the world thought that would be a good idea to call it? And I think they must have had some infighting in the marketing department, because there's a couple of sentences here about, they say the New Testament isn't the gospel put to music, and it's not a religion trip. So they're trying to, you know, so if they're so concerned about distancing themselves from folks thinking this is a religious album, I mean, that's fair. The religious market is a limited market, and you're not going to sell as many if people think it is. So they go to this trouble of explaining that that's not really what this is. It's not really a religious album. And yet, you know, somebody else says, no, we got to call this New Testament. And, but by the way, that is what this is supposed to say. It looks like New Gestamert, but it's in script, and it's really New Testament. It's just kind of hard to read. And so the Australian, this is an Australian copy of it. It's basically, otherwise, the same cover. I just thought it was interesting that and pretty wise that they simplified the cover. This came out in April of 71, the original one, the domestic album. And Joe Perilli, as I mentioned before, is playing percussion on this one. I mentioned his name before. He's playing percussion on this, probably like Oyo y Como Va. And this has some of my favorite stuff on it. Their version of Free I just love. I think, as I've said before, I think they were trying to do a heavy guitar album. It's got a whole lot of love by Led Zeppelin on there. And then they do a vocal, a really good tune called Good Morning Captain. And so there's some very good originals on here as well. But the album just completely flopped. And so they never went back and tried heavy guitar stuff again. They went very into middle of the road, Carpenters and Jim Croce and Cher and Isaac Hayes songs. You know, they never went back to this style again. I thought I'd quickly show some of the laser discs. These aren't LPs anymore, I recently started collecting all the laser discs. They're cheap now. People are getting rid of them, and I happen to have a laser disc player. And I said, "Well, it'd be fun to see what some of these look like." They've all come out since on DVD. This is, I don't know if this one's on DVD. It probably is. If not, it's on a bootleg DVD, I'm sure. But this is the laser disc of them playing the Starwood in 1980, I think it was. And what a great return to the... I remember those days. This was so great. Now, I wasn't at this actual concert. I did see them around that same time, though. And, you know, they played the Go-Go's. They played Surfing and Spying on Here, which was a Go-Go song. They do a great version of it. I'm not sure the Go-Go's didn't come up on stage with them. It might be on this one, where they came up on stage and help them out, but I shouldn't commit to that. Anyway, that's a cool laser disc. This one's a great one with a bunch of stars on it. Jeff Scott Baxter's on here. Peter Frampton's on here. Rick Derringer's on here. Max Weinberg does a drum duo with Mel. The 30th Anniversary Venture Super Session. Middle 80s is when this came out. When it came out, I don't know, 85, 86, 80. I don't think it was much later than that. But, oh yeah, here we go. There's Skunk Baxter. I don't know, is that Paul Warren? He always played a Flying V. There's Peter Frampton when he still had all his hair. And it's a wonderful album of where all these stars join them on a video. And Live in Japan 1990, a really good live album. Well, I was happy to find out that it was on video, and it was on a Laserdisc first. Well, it might have been on VHS as well, simultaneously when it originally came out. Now, I'm quite sure this one's on DVD now. Live in Japan 1990. And it's a good live show. This is In Concert 1994. A little disappointed in this in that it's kind of an abbreviated version. I think it's the VHS version of this that is much more complete. It's got the complete concert, and this is kind of abridged. Not kind of, it is abridged. So that's unfortunate, but it's still good. It's got some good stuff. In Concert, Wild Again concert. Boy, was that a popular thing when they did they started covering some old songs they hadn't ever done before. So I think quite a few of them, and so they had this Wild Again concert in 1997. I can't read any of the titles, they're all Japanese. I think all of these are Japanese releases. Yes, they are. Japanese laser discs. I don't know that there was ever a domestic Ventures laser disc. This didn't come out in 66, obviously. It's a laser disc, though, of their film that came out in Japan in 1966 that has some wonderful live black and white footage of the Ventures. It'd be nice if it were color, but it's black and white. And unfortunately, it's all dubbed in Japanese. They took out all the English, so you don't know what they're saying. You see them talking, and it's showing them with the Japanese dub. But wonderful song. Stop Action's on here. Telstar and Slaughter on 10th Avenue. Bumblebee Twist. They play them at a pretty good gait. You know, they're pretty energetic on this thing. And they're playing their Moserites. And great footage. Great footage of the Ventures, but that's a laser disc of that thing. Let's open this thing up now. This is, again, Walked Over, a sealed copy of Walked Over Run Volume 2. And if I have enough of a fingernail here, I'm going to open it. I've got it sliced here. Split open. There we go. Some of these are not as easy to open. This is, there we go. Well, let's see what's inside. This one's not anywhere near as exciting as the one I did last time. There's no advertising cover. But it's going to be a nice clean copy, and indeed it is. So, if you want to see a much more exciting unveiling of a Sealed Ventures album, check out the video I did previously. This is a later Dalton label. It's not the last of the Dalton labels, but It's anyway, so I just got a new turntable, so I'll have fun putting that on and listening to it. And anyway, thanks for watching.